district councillor elected in Hong Kong, and I'm the chief executive officer of Designing Hong Kong. And we're a member of the World Urban Campaign with UN Habitat. We started on the first Urban Thinker Campus. We joined in Caserta in Italy, and we recently organized an Urban Thinker Campus in Hong Kong to discuss this document, The City We Need. And one of the key issues that is relevant for Hong Kong, which is a city with a very low ownership of cars, a very high usage of public transport. We have a city with a very long longevity for people. The living environment is healthy. I mean, we have all the basic infrastructure. People have a home. So as a city, we're quite successful. But the issue is really the right to the city. It's the cost of living. And that's a phenomenon we now see around the world in many of the major cities, New York, London, Paris. I mean, they're all facing this issue of the rising cost of living in the city. So who has a right to the city? And that's a question that in Hong Kong is even more complicated by the fact that our boundary with the nation to which we belong, China, is a boundary that still very much exists because we've got our own political system, our own legal system. The values are very different across the both sides of the boundary. There is a whole discussion about do we really fit into China or not. And this discussion goes on. There is also the migration issue, the pressure from people coming across from China to Hong Kong. And the fact that we can control our boundary means that there is a lot of discussion about actually how do you then control that, where other cities may not have that. So within that difficult environment, we have how do we deal with the people that are living in Hong Kong and who has a right to live? With a very high percentage, about 50% of the people that live in public housing, so there's some strong social housing program. But the people that fall out of that net, their fight for space is enormous. So we have subdivided units, people living in cage homes, people living in small spaces, and it's very expensive to live. It's hard for young people to start up coming out of university. So the right to the city is a real question. Who owns the land? You've got a small group of families that own a lot of the property, that have control over the development industry, property development industry. They control that. And so there are all these questions about how Hong Kong will go forward. So that is the right to the city question that is dominating. The principles that have been discussed is then participation in a discussion, the right of the public to participate in a discussion of how do you shape the city, but also how to take the successes from Hong Kong and make them alive for other cities around the world. I mean, some of the things happening in Hong Kong are great examples for other urban developments of how you can get a very high efficiency in transport energy usage because you have a lot of people in high density using public transport, not using private cars. What we call transport-oriented developments, so where you're looking at your development together with how transport is organized so people have access and mobility all right there where they live. Mixed uses. And in all of those aspects, Hong Kong has been quite successful, and Hong Kong can be an example for other urban development and conglomerations. So all of that are things that we have discussed at our Urban Thinkers Campus. We've looked at the principles that set out in the City We Need document. We recommended some changes, and some of them have been adopted today. And we hope that the document will be approved together with the changes Hong Kong has proposed. And in that way, we hope we've contributed to how do we do good urban development around the world.